So today's class, I hope I'm audible to everyone. Today's class is on drowning and its medical legal importance. So drowning is a form of asphyxia due to aspiration of fluid caused by submersion in water or any other liquid except the body's own fluids. And submersion means putting or plunging of the person under the water. So submersion is basically when the person is put under water, so water may or may not enter the body, whereas for drowning to occur, there should be some aspiration of fluid into either the oral cavity or nasal cavity or into the lower respiratory tract. So the annual incidence as per WHO is about 4 lakh cases worldwide, and it is the second leading cause of death from unintentional injury after road traffic accidents. And half of the mortality in drowning cases occur in the age of less than 15 years. So these are just a classification based on various aspects of drowning. So one is the wet drowning, which is the most common type, primary and typical. I'll be explaining these later. The second, dry drowning, then secondary or post-immersion or near drowning. And lastly is the immersion syndrome. And the wet drowning, these are again of two types, depending on the water body in which drowning occurs. It can be fresh water or salt water. So wet drowning is when some fluid, either fresh or salt water, is swallowed and inhaled, and the water reaches all the way to the lower respiratory tract. So respiratory passages get waterlogged, and the fatal period is usually within minutes. The cause of death is cardiac arrest, hyperkalemia, or ventricular fibrillation. So whereas in dry drowning, it is more commonly seen in children, alcoholics, sedatives, and hypnotics. Where like they have taken sedatives or hypnotics. So it is most commonly a diagnosis by exclusion. The water does not reach all the way inside the respiratory passages, but there occurs occlusion due to the sudden exposure to the water. This common signs of asphyxia will be present, such as congestion, cyanosis, petechial hemorrhages. The trachea is usually congested and lungs are virtually dry. So dry drowning occurs because there occurs an occlusion in the upper or usually the upper respiratory tract, that is at the level of the epiglottis and the vocal cords. And this occurs due to a sudden shock due to exposure to the fluid. So no water enters into the lungs and laryngospasm occurs, which results in asphyxia. And because that asphyxia has occurred due to exposure of the fluid, it is called as drowning. So this is called as dry drowning. Post-immersion syndrome is syndrome which occurs where the patient survives beyond 24 hours after near drowning, and he was removed from the aqueous environment. So there is no exposure to the fluid at the time of death, but he was exposed to it at a time more than 24 hours ago. So the victim may survive, or he may die later due to secondary complications, which include post-hypoxic encephalopathy, primary alveolar and membrane dysfunction, or loss of surfactant. So, signs and symptoms include, usually signs and symptoms develop within 7 hours of the event, but it can occur even after 24 hours. They range from agitation and alertness to a stage of coma. Common findings are cyanosis, coughing, and the production of frothy pink sputum. Tachypnea, tachycardia, low-grade fever, rails or rails, ronchi or wheeze. Then signs of associated trauma to the head and neck might be seen. That occurs when the victim impacts to some other object present within the pond or the lake or wherever they were found. So this is usually the chain of events that occur in drowning. So initially there is submersion, that is, the body is has come in contact with the fluid. Then there is inspiration, where the fluid enters the respiratory tracts. The water enters the lungs. So this occurs in wet drowning, not in dry drowning. Then there are decompensatory mechanisms, neuronal dysfunction, cardiac dysfunction, and finally brain death and somatic death. So immersion syndrome is where asphyxia or death occurs. Not because the fluid enters the respiratory tract, but because of the extremes of the extremes of temperature, usually the cold temperature that happens when the fluid is exposed to the body. So it is also called as hydrocution or submersion inhibition. it occurs in temperate zones and cold zones. So sudden immersion in icy cold waters or the cold water even entering the other passages such as the eardrums or nasal passage, and as well as water striking the epigastric. So in such cases, there's a powerful stimulation of the parasympathetic nerve ending, which causes vagal inhibition and cardiac arrest. So other causes of death in a case of, it's not in drowning actually, but in cases where immersion has occurred. So a body found lying in water. So in, the death can be due to drowning. It can also be due to impact due to the vital organs by hard objects. It can be due to hypoxemia, metabolic acidosis, post-hypoxic encephalopathy, due to exhaustion, long QT syndrome, etc. So shallow water drowning, it usually occurs when there is when the person who is submerged in the water is unconscious, either like when the person is an alcoholic, he was under the influence of alcohol, an infant who couldn't save themselves, epileptics, drug person suffering from heart disease, or rendered unconscious due to head injury. So these can, in such type of situations, drowning can occur even in shallow water. So the mechanism of drowning here is the stage one surprise. It lasts usually 5 to 10 seconds, basically inactive, and the person may inhale once or twice. The first stage of respiratory arrest lasts about 1 minute. There are vigorous attempts to resurface, and usually the mouth is shut. Stage three is a deep respiration, which lasts about 1 minute. The person takes deep breaths, expels white foam. Agitation tends to cease, and eyes and mouth open and may swallow a few times. Fourth stage is the respiratory arrest, or the second stage of respiratory arrest, which lasts about a minute. Hypoxic convulsions occur. Then the last one is the terminal gasp, which lasts for about 30 seconds, about 3 or 4 respiratory movements, and results in hypoxemia or acute respiratory distress syndrome. So coming to the pathophysiology of drowning, like I said earlier, it is different in freshwater and saltwater drowning. So both are wet drowning, where the water reaches all the way to the lungs. So in case of freshwater, there is inhalation of water into a respiratory tract while crying or screaming or attempting to breathe while submerged in the fluid. So water is absorbed into circulation and results in gross increase in blood volume and hemodilation. So if you are comparing freshwater and salt water, freshwater is dilute when compared to the plasma. So because the water in the lungs, which came from drowning, is dilute, there is movement of water from the lungs into the circulation. So that results in increase in blood volume and hemodilation. Now when the blood gets diluted again, there is movement of water from the blood plasma into the RBC because of the change in because of the hypoosmolar thing, and so this results in swelling of RBC and rupture of RBC, which liberates a large amount of potassium into the bloodstream, and that results in electrolyte imbalance, which can also cause ventricular fibrillation, cerebral anoxia, and death in usually 4 to 5 minutes. Now, when you're comparing to saltwater drowning, saltwater is hyperosmolar, or it has more solutes when compared to the blood plasma. So the movement of water is in the opposite direction. It goes away from the, it moves from the blood to the respiratory tract. So in saltwater drowning, there is inhalation of water into respiratory tract. Water is removed from circulation and enters the alveolar space, resulting in hemoconcentration and massive pulmonary edema. RBCs become crenated. So the water flows out of the RBC, so resulting in a multiple like spiculated appearance. There is hemoconcentration, crenated RBC, which leads to myocardial anoxia, and death occurs a little more delayed when compared to the freshwater drowning in 8 to 12 minutes. So diagnosis of death by drowning, you look for the external signs, internal signs, a few biochemical and biophysical tests, and analysis of diatomaceous particles material. So the external signs include the clothing on the body, so which are usually soggy wet, then the body surface again due to large exposure to the fluid environment, they show some certain changes, we'll be discussing that. Postmortem hypostasis, it's usually bright pink in color, and if you remember, in a person who is like not in a fluid area, like in a normal dead body, postmortem hypostasis develops later on, and initially it is not fixed, whereas later it gets fixed. But in case of drowning, where the body is submerged in a fluid, in a body of fluid where there is constant moving, like for example, in a flowing river. So in such case, due to the constant moving of the body, the postmortem hypostasis does not get fixed in one person. There is a delay in fixation of the lividity. And usually the body floats in a prone position. So the face is down, buttocks are up, and the legs or hands are hanging down. So PML goes into the dependent part. So on the face, the front of neck, front of chest and abdomen, the ends of the limbs, that is the hands and feet. Then there is cutis anserina, that is for goose flesh. It's generalized pimpling or puckering of the skin, and it occurs due to erector pili muscle spasm. But this finding is not specific for drowning. So in this case, you can see the fluid, etc., that is coming out of the nose and mouth, as well as the deep congestion of the face when compared to the back of the body. And what is seen in the second picture is the mud or dirt particles that were recovered from the water body, as well as you can see the hands which are having a whitish bleached appearance. That is due to continuous exposure to a fluid environment. So the face, their conjunctiva usually congested, petechial hemorrhages. Like I said, the face and so including the eyes, they are going to be in the dependent part of the dependent position, and there is going to be pooling of blood there. The pupils will be dilated, tongue will be swollen and protruded. Foam or froth will continuously be extruded from the mouth and nostrils. They occur within 2 minutes of drowning, and the characteristics are that they are fine, white, lathery and tenacious. On wiping, that is when the external body is wiped, the fluid tends to reappear. That is, there is a continuous discharge from the mouth and nose. And the bubbles that are seen in the foam, they don't readily collapse when touched with a pin or point of the knife. So you can see the deep congestion of the face and eyes that is seen in this case, as well as the froth that is coming out of the nose. And you can see the small white dots. That is the lathery or tenacious appearance. With a large amount of froth. So rigor mortis tends to appear early, and cadaveric spasm, that is occurs when the drowning man, like, he clutches at something. And if you remember cadaveric spasm, if you remember rigor mortis, there is initially a phase of relaxation, then rigor mortis, and then the secondary relaxation. Whereas in cadaveric spasm, the primary relaxation is bypassed. It directly goes into the spasm or the rigor mortis. And it occurs when there is like a sudden type of death where the patient is excited or agitated at the moment of death. So in drowning, usually the drowning person is seen clutching at whatever objects he could find in the this one as an attempt to escape. Then washer movements, hand and feet, that is what I told earlier, the wrinkling of the skin and bleaching. This is due to the continuous exposure to the fluid. So it there is first initially there is a wrinkling of the skin, then there is bleaching of the cuticle, bleaching, corrugation and shortening, which happens in 24 hours, and later on in by about 48 hours cuticle begins to separate from the palms and hands and sole of the feet. So washer movements, hands and feet, they are not specific for drowning, they are specific for immersion. So a person found on the river side or on a pool side with maybe just his hands or feet inside the water, whereas the rest of the body is remaining outside, even such a person is going to develop the washer movements and feet. So as you can see in the top image, there is a wrinkling of the skin, shortening and bleached appearance, that is the whitish color change of the fingers. And in the bottom feet, again for the feet, bottom picture of the feet, there is the wrinkling of the skin. These are suggestive of immersion, not of drowning. So flotation of the body. In many cases, initially the drowning body gets immersed in the fluid, whereas and while once decomposition starts, the body tends to resurface due to the excess accumulation of gases within the body. In summer, this occurs within 24 hours, whereas in winters, it is occurs usually after 2 to 3 days. Then there are usually presence of injuries that occur while the patient has fallen down. So if maybe they are hitting the bottom of the water body, so that can result in injuries, or maybe if they had tripped and then fell into the water body, those will also result in blunt trauma injuries. Putrefactive changes, they are slow inside water, but the moment the body is retrieved from water, it rapidly progresses. And again, it follows Casper's dictum, the time for decomposition. So 1:2:8. So the highest, so the lowest time or the maximum rate or the rapidity in which decomposition starts is the highest for air. And this is twice the time it takes in water, and 8 times the time if the body is buried in earth. So if a body is immersed in water, it takes almost twice the time when compared to the body exposed to air for decomposition to start. And decomposition usually starts over the dependent parts like head, neck and chest, and in over 4 to 10 days. So this is another case of drowning which you can see here. But more importantly, you can see the decomposition which has come over the face as well as the upper part of neck and chest. So these were the dependent parts while the person was immersed in the body, and so this is where decomposition has started. Internal signs include the lungs, voluminous, bulky, waterlogged and overinflated, filling the chest cavity and overlapping heart. So in freshwater drowning, due to the excess water getting accumulated in the lungs, as well as in the salt water due to the pulmonary edema. So in both cases, pulmonary edema occurs, which results in a voluminous and bulky lungs. Then Poulthoff's hemorrhage, there are type of hemorrhage that occur due to rupture of the alveolar septi, which results in increased pressure during forced expiration, and it gives a red tinge to the edema fluid. So there is generalized edema and distension, but this tends to minimize the appearance of Poulthoff's hemorrhage. So basically these are just hemorrhages that occur due to the rupture of alveolar septi, and they are usually seen near the pleural surfaces, and they are commonly seen in drowning. So emphysema acuosum, it is in a person who has survived from drowning. So the victim is alive and conscious. So frothy foams are created due to the violent respiratory efforts. Edema fluid blocked passive collapse of alveoli, holding the lungs in inspiratory position. So the lungs can't contract, expiration does not occur, and due to the violent efforts, the foam is created. And valvular action of the bronchial obstruction results in over distension of the lungs. So this is the froth seen within the respiratory passages and the overinflated or over bulky and voluminous lungs. Then edema acuosum, it occurs when pulmonary edema is developed to such an extent that the person is unable to breathe on his own, resulting in unconscious. So the victim is alive but unconscious. So there are no efforts by the patient to respire. Water enters passively into the respiratory passages, and usually there is no froth. Then hydrostatic lung, these are seen in postmortem drowning cases. So due to the sheer hydrostatic pressure, water enters inside the lungs. But in such cases, the pulmonary edema or the frothy fluid that comes, those won't be present. So this that, and then the other findings include in the heart and blood vessels, there is distension of the right heart and great veins, obstruction of pulmonary circulation, which results in back pressure and dilatation of right side of heart, and the blood becomes more fluid. Stomach contents, if medium contains some peculiar substance, like for example in the water body where the person had drowned. So due to the respiratory efforts, the fluid as well as the other substances present in the water body, they are entering both the respiratory passages as well as the stomach. So some substances, like for example sand or mud or dirt particles, which or some maybe it can be some vegetation as well, those that were present in the water body can be found in the stomach contents of the victim. And some disagreeable material like muddy water, liquid manure, etc. can also be present. And absence of water in the stomach, these occur in immersion syndrome as well as in when in putrefaction due to the large amount of gases getting collected. Then hemorrhages in the middle ear, these are rare, and they occur due to the increased venous and capillary pressure due to the large respiratory efforts. There is penetration into the middle ear of inhaled liquid by the eustachian tube, and this results in barotrauma. So another place where the water collects are the paranasal sinuses. So there is free liquid present, and these are most commonly seen in the maxillary and the sphenoid sinuses, and this is also known as Sveshnikov's sign. Then in the spleen, there is sympathetic stimulation, which results in vasoconstriction and contraction of the spleen capsule. So another value that we discuss here is the drowning index, that is comparison of weight of both lungs along with pleural effusion and weight of spleen. So the value is much greater than 14.1, it is it is suggestive of drowning, whereas a lower value is suggestive of another cause of death. Then chemical changes, like I discussed earlier, in fresh water there is hemodilution due to the movement of water from the lungs into the blood, and the plasma sodium level decreases and potassium increases because of the rupture of RBCs and entry of potassium from RBCs into the plasma. In salt water, there is increase in the sodium levels, not because sodium moves into the blood, but because the water moves from blood into the respiratory passages. So these are a few biophysical tests which we'll be discussing now. One is the Carrara test. Due to disproportionate dilution of the left heart blood in fresh water, whereas salt water based on the specific gravity and freezing point. So marked dilution of the left heart blood in freshwater drowning. So Gettler's test, this compares the chloride contents in both the left and right side of the heart. In normal case, non-drowning, concentration is 600 milligram per 100 ml, and a difference between two sides of heart of more than 25 milligram percentage indicates drowning. In freshwater, chloride content is more on the left side of the heart. Another test is the Mortis test. The Mortis suggested that magnesium is more reliable than chlorides, and especially in seawater drowning. So this measures the magnesium levels in plasma, and again the difference between the left and right side of heart is measured. Then another test is the comparison of specific gravity of plasma by Fremont et al. Positive values, the death are caused by other than drowning as well. Histological findings, those are specifically for the lung. There is acute dilatation of the alveoli with extension, elongation and thinning of the septa, compression of the alveolar capillaries, study on alveolar macrophages, the number of alveolar macrophages per alveolus without consideration of the alveolar size. So there is no relevant difference between drowning and non-drowning death. Then coming to diatoms, diatoms are a class of microscopic unicellular algae. Now the thing about diatoms is that they show a wide range of patterns or shapes of the diatomaceous particles, and this pattern of like shape and size, they usually vary from body to different water bodies. So if a person has been recovered from a water body and the fluid, there are diatoms present in his body, so those diatoms can be compared with different water bodies to find out from which water body drowning had occurred. So around 15,000 species are known of the diatoms. A few classifications are present, which include the oligohalophilic, mesohalophilic and polyhalophilic. So the mechanism is that on entry of the person into the water body, and which contains the diatoms, so due to some respiratory efforts, the diatoms enters the lung, which again via the lung enters the bloodstream and is circulated over the entire body. So in they are usually concentrated in organs such as the brain, bone marrow and kidney, and in a dead body these organs are again removed and then tested for the presence of diatoms, which can be confirmed by microscopy. So the methods of extraction include direct digestion by acids, that is nitric and sulfuric acid, enzymatic digestion by proteinase K, strong anionic detergents like sodium dodecyl sulfate, and by heating. Then indirect digestion by incineration. So incineration is basically exposing the tissue to high heat, and the tissue degenerates, disintegrates, but the diatoms are highly resistant to heat, so they do not disintegrate, and the incinerated sample can be taken up for microscopic examination. Then other methods include ultrasonic radiation and direct microscopic examination of the body fluids. So femur and sternum are the most useful and least contaminated sample. So these are ideal for diatom examination. So around 2 to 5 grams of tissues, or in case of bone marrow, 40 grams of tissue are collected. They undergo a curettage and in the Zeldahl flask. So using nitric acid with the amount of 5 times the sample, it's heated for a few hours or left for a few days at room temperature, centrifuged, and then the distillate is examined under the microscope. So if diatoms are present, diagnosis of drowning can be ascertained. But please remember that this is not the specific diagnosis for drowning. A past exposure or a past inhalation of water from the body, and which the patient had survived, that can also result in deposition of diatoms in the bone, and so this is not specific for a death due to drowning. So some cases of death from drowning show no diatoms, maybe because the enough circulation did not happen, so the diatoms could not get deposited in the organs. And like I said earlier, diatoms have been found in the organs of person who have died from causes other than drowning. So recent studies, which are again being analyzed to be specific for drowning, however, these have not been accepted as universal methods. So one example is the analysis of the blood strontium levels, quantitative histomorphometric study using a computer-assisted image analyzer. Then the blood strontium levels and of the water strontium are usually found to be much higher than in the non-drowning subjects. They are usually useful in the diagnosis of death by drowning, which occurred in seawater, but use in freshwater is limited. Then another study is the assessment of surfactant protein in fatal drowning. So that is surfactant protein immunohistochemistry. So they usually show a granular pattern staining, and they are highly, I mean, strongly positive in drowning cases. Then another newer study that is coming is the hemolytic staining of the intima of the aortic root, usually seen in freshwater drowning cases. So there was a case control study in which 5% of cases were found to be positive for staining, whereas in the control group, no staining was found. So the role of virtual autopsy, that is use of postmortem CT scan in the diagnosis of antemortem drowning, many such studies are being conducted. So one such study was performed by Kawasumi et al. And they found that fluid accumulation in the maxillary or sphenoidal sinuses, these are associated significantly with drowning. Other changes that have been noticed, but again, they were not specific to drowning, include the changes in trachea and bronchi, that is the collection of the edematous fluid, and changes in the pulmonary parenchyma, which show pulmonary edema and bronchoconstriction. So this you can see, these are the sinuses, the maxillary and the sphenoid. So there is a collection of fluid which is more dense compared to the soft tissue or the mucus lining in the sinuses. So the more dense fluid, that is suggestive of drowning or fluid accumulation in the sinuses. That's it for today's class. Thank you.